Welcome back to Proactive London, where I'm talking to Mark Child now. He's the CEO of Condor Gold, and we've got plenty to talk about, Mark. But before we delve into that, how are you doing today?
Fine, thanks. Fine. Just arrived in Nicaragua yesterday.
Absolutely. All part of your efforts to sell the La India mine. It's been ongoing, hasn't it, that sale process. And we've had another development. Your chairman, Jim Mellon, has put £1 million in order to extend the runway and keep that sales process on track, hasn't he?
Yes, he has. And we're very fortunate to have Jim Mellon as chairman of the company. Not only is an outstanding investor over the last 40 years, and he called the gold price absolutely spot on at the beginning of the year for anyone who's watching at the Master Investor Conference. But he's chairman and 25% shareholder now of Condor Gold. And it's notable when he says in the announcement that, you know, I'm impressed with the execution on the ground of what we've done with the project. And I'll go into that in a minute. But also, we're fully aware of the valuation of the project. So it's a top-up financing, effectively, to, you know, see us through the sales process, which has advanced considerably.
That's right. So last time you and I spoke, it was back in September, and you'd been showing people the mine. You know, you had a lot of interest. And I guess that process has really just continued since. But tell us what that 3 months has looked like from your point of view.
Yes, we've had three site visits, which we actually discussed last time. And we continue to get sort of new people interested. As the gold price goes up, more people get interested, and some people drop other projects and look at our project. The reason I suppose we haven't reached a definitive sale agreement is really just on price. And that comes back to the chairman, Jim Mellon's comment on, we're fully aware of the valuation. And if we wanted to sort of almost give the project away compared with its real valuation, we could have done so already. So we asked all shareholders to be sort of patient with us, because as a executive team and with the chairman's support, we have the directors and chairman own 27%, 28% of the company. So we all want to maximize the value for shareholders. So I'm in Nicaragua today. For example, this afternoon, I have a meeting with the Chinese embassy in Nicaragua. That is a follow-on meeting from previous meetings when we've had large Chinese groups coming through Nicaragua, which I've hosted on site visits. We are now in advanced discussions with two particular parties. We have eight companies under NDAs, and those three site visits have been completed. So although nothing can be guaranteed, and there's a cautionary disclaimer on the announcement, you know, there's good interest in the project for reasons I'll go into if we want to discuss that.
Well, the project itself has never really been the issue, has it, Mark? I suppose the issue really is this, that it's not in one of those recognised absolute top-tier jurisdictions. Is that fair to say?
Oh, well, thank you for pointing that out. I mean, if this was in a top-tier jurisdiction of Canada, Australia, Nevada, it would have, the market capitalization would be several times higher, and we would have been sold before it even got to this stage. So when you're in Nicaragua, you have to de-risk the project even more. So you have to go through the feasibility studies, you have to buy all the land, you have to get all the permits to construct and operate the project, you have to get a SAG mill in, you have to get it absolutely construction ready and de-risk it as much as possible. Because the perception is, unfortunately with US sanctions against Nicaragua, that there's the geopolitical risk. And that's a perception if you pick up the New York Times or whatever. And it's true from an American perspective, you know, but there are plenty of potential buyers out there who are not American or North American, particularly the Chinese, and there are other parties who don't care about that. But obviously we're a listed entity, and there's a suffering on that perception. But we do own 100%, and you just have to look at sort of West Africa. There's been eight coup d'etats in the last 18 months to 2 years. Nicaragua is very stable. The government's very supportive of mining. And that's another key thing. There are many countries where you can't get a permit these days, or they're not supportive. And the tax regime on royalty, as which 3% goes to the government, 30% corporation, hasn't changed since I've been coming here for over 12 years. So let's hope that continues. But it's a stable mining regime, and the government are very supportive, and gold is the number one export for Nicaragua.
So just finally, Mark, from your point of view, is the path from here to a successful sale essentially just more of the same from your side, and hoping that increasing interest, perhaps motivated by a higher gold price, is really going to be the thing that gets you over the line.
Yes, there is. So we have plan B. So, for example, we have plans to put a pilot plant into production. We have plans on an artisanal miner thing. We have plans to do this on a smaller scale. It's so economic on whichever way you look at it. We can do all that. But the board for the moment is looking to set the strategy to sell the assets and not go through a construction phase. And we as a feel that more exploration companies shouldn't try and be builders of mines. You know, we're not mine builders, so we're just putting on a plate for somebody else. But just before we perhaps sign off, so a bit more of the same to answer your question. And we now we're in this point in December, we don't see anything being announced in the next 2 weeks because everything shuts down really from the 15th, 16th of December. So new year, we have meetings with gold producers set up, and we hope to be able to conclude something in the new year. Valuation wise, if I just touch on it briefly, the feasibility study which was discussed is 80,000 ounces of gold a year. But if we add in feeder pits and we add in underground, we get to 150,000 ounces of gold a year. The all-in sustaining cash cost is, on the open pit scenario, is $813 an ounce. That's already published with us. So it's less than half the gold price. So the margins are fantastic on this. The head grade is 3.6 grams per ton. In fact, the resource grade is 3.6, but we can high grade it to over four grams a ton. So this throws off huge amounts of cash. There's a 12-month payback on the FS capex is only 106 million. If we do the bigger scenario, it can be $140 million. But in mining terms, that's very small. And just if we take gold at where it is, if we take gold at 1600, $400 lower, which is we did the FS at, there's still $350 million out of a single pit of operating profit after the government royalty. So that more than repays the capex. It's three times the capex out of just the FS. If we add in the upside potentials of 150, then we get $1 billion of operating profit out of this. And our market cap, what's our market cap? $36 million US dollars. It's absurdly cheap right now. My opinion is... that's what $15 an ounce in the ground versus, so it's 0.7% of the gold price. So I think there'll come a time when if gold I think is broken out, 2024 looks great, interest rates pivoting down, and the other gold share prices are going up, the currency increases, the M&A side will continue with a frenzy I think in the sector in the new year. And that'll lead to more people looking to replace depleting assets. And here's a shovel-ready project.
Very best of luck with it, Mark. And thank you very much, as always, for your candor and your time. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, too.